Hey, Fanboy Nation.
This is your pal Daffy Duck, and you're watching.
We're watching. You're watching Fanboy.
Fanboy, etc.
Fanboy Nation.
Dot, I assume, no. Tom.
Today I'm speaking with a man behind a movie that is like Fight Club meets The Raid meets Die Hard and Lionheart and so many other great things. Writer, director, James Kermack, how are you today?
I'm good, thank you, man. How are you doing?
I am great, man. This movie was a lot of big, crazy fun.
Good. That's what I like to hear.
Some aspects of rock and roller in there. You know, you can tell you got your inspiration from British action films and American action movies of the late 80s and early 90s. And yes. And some Indonesian films, like I mentioned, The Raid. There's a lot going on here to unpack, man.
Yeah, there's a lot of influences. I mean, it's very 80s influenced, obviously. And then I think, you know, Guy Ritchie's stuff is very 80s influenced. And so obviously that comes through as well. And as soon as you put British accents on it, you're going to get the Guy Ritchie thing as well. But yeah, it's very 80s influenced. There's so much in there. And it's kind of... you know, it's a lot of it's a big homage to the films that I loved as a kid and grew up watching and wanted to make myself.
Well, the movie is available now in the United States and in the UK. What's been the British reaction to the film? And then we'll go into the American reaction because it's two totally different audiences. Even though war has been a cultural phenomenon for, you know, 10,000 years of recorded history and even before so.
Yeah, I mean, it's been really good, to be honest. I mean, the film is... For an independent film, it's got a lot going on. It's got huge aspirations, and I think you know, the British audience take the Guy Ritchie thing first. The American audience jump to the Tarantino thing first. The Raid always comes up, or Old Boy comes up at some point between the two. But yeah, the reactions have been really great, really interesting, really varied, which is very nice because we wanted to make something that you know, pushed a lot of buttons. And was not an easy vanilla sell, would make you think whilst hopefully entertaining you. And so, yeah, we're super happy so far.
I can't really equate this to British cinema because I'm not too familiar with the history of it. But in American cinema, we had our ebb and flow of big studio productions, pre-code, you know, more darker films. Then the code went back to mainstream and then, you know, the ebb and flow of major mainstream studio films and then independent films. In the United States, we're back into our independent cycle, you know, taking over and dominating. I mean, we still have the Marvel movies and the DC movies, which I love beyond compare, especially since I was a comic book kid and still am. But yeah. It's, you know, it's the indie films that are making a comeback and it's the storytelling. What is that like in the UK when it comes to independent films and storytelling in comparison to a major studio?
I think I'm hoping that the cycle, like you said, I think it's happening in the US and I think it's going to happen in the UK as well, where we get back to a bit more of the, you know, the 70s, not where we have a Michael Camino ruining a whole studio with Heaven's Gate sort of situation, but a bit more where you have the real story led, where it's not huge budgets, but it's kind of risk telling stories, great actors. You know, one of my favorite films is obviously the 80s, but it's like Blowout, the De Palma film, and that for me is like the French Connection, like these kind of films which weren't massive budgets but great storytelling, took some risks, great actors. And I think we are hopefully coming back around that again. Like, I don't think the Marvel films will stop or anything like that, they're still going to be there, but I think also with what's happening with theaters shutting down and stuff, I think budgets are going to have to come down, in which case directors are going to have to get more creative. So I think it's a very interesting place to be.
And don't get me wrong, I'm still looking forward to Wonder Woman on Christmas from DC and then Spider-Man 3 from Marvel. But I do love a story-driven film. And this is there, but there's humor, there's action, there's just, you know, big, booming craziness going on. And then you have, you know, so much in it with Mo's character. And him being the lone survivor, essentially, known as Hard Eight, and just everything that just keeps building and building layer-wise. How difficult was it to write a story like this and then present it to someone and go, all right, I need X amount of pounds to put this together?
It was interesting. I mean, it was a challenge because I really wanted to challenge the audience with the structure. So obviously we know Hard Eight is alive at the beginning. He's being interviewed for much of the film in the police station, which means that when we are flashbacking to fight sequences, people know he's going to live through it, but the fight sequences have to be exciting enough and thrilling enough for you to still go along with them and really enjoy them. And so that was something we worked on with the stunt coordinator, obviously, Pete Pedrero. So it was a challenge, because if the fights didn't work, I don't think anyone would be happy to go back to the story again, because it would feel like you were just jumping back and forth. And so, yeah, going to get money for it was interesting. So I've had the project for about 10 years, from script to screen, working on it a very long time. And originally I wrote it to try and, I used to be an actor, so to push myself as an actor. And I got some very good advice from a guy called Rob Mitchell in the industry, who basically bought me a lovely glass of wine and said, I love the script, it's fantastic, it's mad, it's crazy. You can't be the lead, please hire someone else, you're a nobody. and it was really brutal, because I thought I was going to have some kind of, you know, Stallone, Avildsen, Rocky kind of situation where it all works out. But he was completely correct, and he said, write yourself a smaller character, get someone who you can sell the film on, and a bigger cast. And so we actually originally started looking for other directors. We discussed with Tony Kay, for instance, American History X, for a while. And so it could have been a completely different kind of film. And it was difficult. I mean, the film is out there with regards to narrative, with what we've done with the visuals, with the size of the cast for a small indie. And so it has been quite hard, but luckily I had a really good producer with Julien Lafleur Futuristic Films, who for the last 4 years has been completely pushing the film by my side. And any film that gets made is an absolute miracle. So my hat's off to anyone who gets anything on screen and anything out. And so, you know, even to be here chatting to you today is such a joy, because it's kind of like through the years, you kind of, this is a much further step along. And it's just a real pleasure to be able to do this.
Well, the pleasure is mine, because you put out such a great film that I was so excited to see it, you know, and Knuckledust, you know, was such an interesting name for the film. When you do something like this, you know, you wrote this 10 years ago and you finally get it produced. This is essentially, you took it from, inception, but I mean inception, but we'll go with the inception thing, to now grade five, where your baby's no longer a baby. He's 10 years old and walking on his own. And now, you know, there's life that was breathed into the film. What's that like for you to finally see it come to fruition and then see everything else just form around it to come to the story that you wanted? Because sometimes we get really married to the words on the page, that to divide ourselves from it makes it more difficult.
It's quite surreal. I think I'm coming out the back end of it now with the release and getting and hearing people's opinions, which is, you know, good or bad, is always great to hear. And so I'm actually starting to be able to reflect on it a little bit and be able to breathe a little bit, which is quite nice. It's fantastic. I mean, it's been so long. I mean, we moved house last month and packing up my stuff, and I found the first screenplay I ever wrote when I was 15. And read through it, and obviously it's unproducible, but it had bits of Knuckledust in it, like character names, there were, you know, a couple of twists and stuff, and I was kind of like, this has been here for a very, very long time. So it feels quite freeing to finally be able to go, do you know what, now I feel like I can really open my horizons and let's make some more stuff and make stuff a bit quicker this time, hopefully.
And out of curiosity, how did you come up with the name Knuckledust for the film?
I was just trying to find something that was punchy, but also kind of just screamed at you and grabbed you as soon as you heard it. And because it's not a real word, you have to listen to it kind of twice. You have to read it twice, two or three times. So I always thought, if they have to read it two or three times, it's going to stick in their head even more. Hopefully they'll want to produce the film or put some money in.
I dig it. And I love the pun. You know, you needed something punchy for a movie called Knuckledust. with all that, you know, I made mention to Sean Patrick Flannery, who did a movie recently about mixed martial arts, and this is underground fighting, so we're keeping in theme. And it also took him 13 years to get that produced. And I made mention of John Bon Jovi when they interviewed him a couple of years ago, and he said, you know, you have your whole life to make your first album a masterpiece, and then once it finally hits, they want a follow-up in 6 months to a year. How does something like Knuckledust, which took a decade to get off the ground and finally produced and is actually being well received, to now people coming to you and go, okay, cool, when's the sequel coming out?
Well, that's been, I mean, that's obviously the aim of the film. You know, it's kind of the way we set it up is a really dirty grindhouse kind of franchise. It's been really nice. I mean, I have lots of ideas which have been forming for some time to go bigger, but not, I find sometimes when you find the sequels from slightly smaller films, they go much bigger and then they forget why the stuff they, when they had little budget, was really interesting. So we've had a few chats about that already, and we've had a few chats about kind of diversifying the franchise element into other areas, which is very interesting. Obviously, there's a lot of, I mean, you grew up comic books, I did too, a lot of comic book influences in there as well, especially with the visuals. And so that's definitely an area we'd like to move into as well, because we have so many great characters who I feel have great backstories, and some of whom obviously die in the film, who I think could do a lot more.
I dig it, man. Here's the thing. I know the movie has just only been recently released in the UK and the United States, but I can't wait for the Blu-ray to come out because I want those special features. What ended up on the cutting room floor that's going to be a Blu-ray feature eventually that I got to keep my eyes open for?
I'll be honest, man. Like, there's not too much that hit the cutting room floor because we were on a tight schedule. We shot this in 5 weeks. It was a small indie budget. It's $2 million. It's a huge cast. We had a lot to shoot every day. You know, our editors were receiving footage and then getting slightly confused because they were kind of like, well, how many days footage is this? And they were like, no, this is one day's footage. James has shot this all in one day. And so I really made sure that what we shot was needed for the film and went in. So I think we ended up dropping one scene from the entire shoot. And that was a scene of my character, to be fair. Because I felt it just kind of doubled up a little bit on what we've already seen. It slowed it down for a second. And so I just thought, I'm the actor, it doesn't bother me. So I took it out. It's literally one scene, I think, we dropped in the whole thing.
Wow, that's extremely humble of you, because I don't think most actor, director, writers would do that for themselves.
Well, I wasn't even, I'll be honest, I originally, up until last summer, I just decided just to direct. I had such a great cast. I was like, you know, this is fantastic. I'm just going to direct and concentrate and be wonderful. And then dates got mixed up with somebody, one of our actors shooting in the US, shooting a really great show up there. It suddenly overlapped. And so I was like, oh God, we're quite late in the day. It was the part I'd already written for myself, like Rob Mitchell told me to. So I just thought, you know what, I'll just do it myself. I at least know I'm on set. We won't have to schedule it. It ended up pretty well, I think. So I'm quite happy with it.
Okay, so you're the second film this week that I've talked to where you've told me the picture was made for under $5 million that looks like a $50 to $90 million project.
No, thank you.
Thank you for being able to pull it off. The thing is that how much has digital helped in lowering the cost where we don't have to worry about film and processing and running out of film or chemicals or whatever else to get them produced on celluloid?
Oh my God, I mean, one day I would absolutely obviously love to shoot something on film, but to shoot something like this on an indie film on film with this times, it just would never happen. I mean, I'm quite economical with what I shoot. I try to do a minimum of two to three takes. I try never to go over that. Some of the shots in the film we had to get in one. For instance, a certain explosion which we got in one take, that's all I had, was one. And film, it just, you know, there was a big divide, I think, before on how much money you had to spend in before digital came in and really helped everyone. And now I think more people obviously have the opportunity to shoot films, so you're going to have a lot more films coming out. But like you said, I think it's what you do with that, because just because it's easy to shoot doesn't mean it's easy to shoot. It still needs to look really high end. So it has helped a lot. We could never have shot this on film. It would have taken three times as long. And it was tough to convince people, you know, as it was, to give me the money. So asking to shoot it on film might have been the auteur step too far.
I agree with you. Probably would have ended up being $20-30 million to make if it was all on film.
And it would have had a different director.
All right, we're going to go back to 15-year-old James writing his first screenplay that somehow or slightly influenced Knuckledust. Take us to, you know, Mama Kermack or Papa Kermack sitting there watching their son right away thinking either this is cute or to go get a real job. And now here you are making films and having such a great reception with Knuckledust.
Well, so my dad passed away when I was 10, but he introduced me to a lot of the films that really influenced this film. So, you know, he bought me my first copy of First Blood. He bought me my first Rocky. You know, he sat down and watched Streets of Fire with me. And the first time I saw Streets of Fire, I don't know if you've seen that film, a Walter Hill film. It's fantastic. It bombed, obviously, when it came out. It's a hybrid of like action and musical and 50s and 80s. It's insane. But I watched it on black and white, on a little black and white television, first time I saw it as a kid. And then when you watch it later with all these colours, and if anyone watches that and watches Knuckledust, you'll see there's a lot of influence there. And Roadhouse, you know. So I watched Roadhouse with him where he'd cover my eyes when the boobs came out and stuff like that. So all of those kind of films really influenced this. And it's quite mad to think that they've stuck there for so long to do that. But my mum and my dad were always, you know, I originally wanted to be a cop, but not an English cop. I wanted to be an American cop, which they kind of said is that might not happen. And then I wanted to be a stuntman. And, you know, everything's kind of always moved towards making movies and stuff. And I was very lucky. My mum was very supportive of that. You know, we came from very, very working class, very poor background. And so, one of the first things she did say when I said I wanted to be an actor was kind of, you know, that's for rich people. you know, we don't have anyone in the family who's a part of that. You know, we're completely separated. So they've been super, my mum's been super supportive, and I imagine my dad would be too. And yeah, it's been good. She's been there, you know, the whole way, and she's very proud. And, you know, she loves the film. She thinks it's absolutely insane. And yeah.
And then when there's nudity in your films, you cover her eyes this time around.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, we're at that point now, so it's fine.
James, you know what? It's Christmas week. Some of us are going to willfully be separated from our families. Some of us are going to be begrudgingly separated from our families. But we have time on our hands. Why should we sit down if we can gather with our families or by ourselves to sit down and watch Knuckledust?
It's crazy. It's mad. There's something for everyone. If you like fights, if you like serious, intense scenes, if you like comedy, there's something for you all. Just obviously, don't have the kids there.
James Kermack, thank you for your time. Where can we find you and the film on social media if we want to connect?
At Jay Kermack on Instagram, and follow at Knuckledust Movie on Instagram.
Perfect. James Kermack, thank you so much for your time. Knuckledust is available on VOD in the United States and the United Kingdom. Happy holidays to you and your family. Congratulations on the move and congratulations on the film.
Thank you. You too, buddy. Have a great Christmas.
Thank you.